This is the Battle of Issus. Moving further forward in our we have still quite a few left, but this is Alexander's, I guess, first real contact with Darius. If you remember before, we did the Granicus, but that didn't include Darius. But now he's gathered his force. He's gotten to, by the way, some players I know like to, you know, play things on an anniversary, like, hey, Waterloo's happening, let's do this, or hey, it's Gettysburg anniversary, let's play this. Well, fortune just has it that it's November, and so this is the 2349th anniversary. Damn, missed it by a year. Of Issus. Well, wait, zero is funny, I'm not sure. Anyway, so Darius has the advantage of having been able to put himself in a position where I believe he's across Alexander's supply line. He has to be attacked. He's chosen his terrain, which is along the river here, the Panarius River. Now, the scenario introduction states that this river is basically unfordable except downstream and one small upstream ford. Maybe this is all the downstream. It's certainly not pleasant to cross because this is a rocky riverbed, which has additional penalties. There's a bunch of slope and such not, so that's going to be problematic. But anyway, Darius puts himself here. He's got a small force in place to try to harass the flanks. Yeah, that's not going to do much. Look at the quality of that stuff. That's the levies that he has. They're not going to do very well. And in fact, that's the problem. Most of his troops are still just not very good. That's what we're going to be facing throughout these scenarios. He's got a ton of skirmishers. At least he's wise enough to put many of them in the second line, but some of them are way or in back. But some of them are in the front where they're possible to cause problems if they route through. They can do the retreat through because I'm playing with more recent rules for that, just because skirmishers are just such a hose otherwise. In terms of the heavy forces, so you've got all these two hex units. These are just peltasts. Underneath some of the units, you have these abatis. These are by choice where you want to put them. It's got to be infantry that's adjacent to the river if you're using the historical setup. There really aren't a lot of interesting places to put it. This is one that I did not put, which I might regret, but I wanted to have this downstream location covered. I wanted to have the flank here covered, and I wanted a little bit in the center where it looks like, you know, just like with here, it looks like attacks might actually happen. For Alexander's army, you'll see there's a plethora of leaders. Now, these are the contingency commanders, and a lot of them, the ones with C's, and one more isn't. This guy's a contingency commander too, even though he doesn't look like one, which is why I've got him reversed. He's only got a range of 4, and he commands the companions. This is going to be kind of a nightmare, but in terms of trying to keep track of everything. But, you know, for example, the agrarians leader here, well, he can command this one agrian unit essentially for no cost when Alexander activates him. But this one's too far away. It's just the way the setup is. Those guys are kind of guarding against the levies that could harass. We've got line commands for the Persians, of course, which is their heavy cav and their light cav can be treated as lines. And remember, those aren't really lines. They're clumps, more like it. Point-wise, both sides have to take 135 losses. quality is way in the Macedonians' favor, but terrain is certainly in Persia's favor. I always have trouble with these because, you know, I'm not really Alexander, so I'm like, geez, I don't just want to storm that shit. It gets ugly. But he should have enough of an advantage here that he can pretty much blast through things. The companion cav forge a way across here and get behind. So I don't see this as too difficult a scenario. In fact, if I'm me, I'll probably throw the companion cav forward and leave the Macedonians not to assault the line until it's already been weakened from behind. Initiative, Alexander gets his cav into charge formation. He's planning on just busting through here, as I mentioned. Pushed some of the Hippopotists forward to cover that flank. I'll start moving units forward. I don't want to push across the river, but I do want to get a little closer to the river with these units. I also dispatched a light cav to help protect against here. These guys are pretty weak, but you know, if they do break through, bad things could happen. This position is actually pretty bad as I start to look at. He's dispatching some of this really crap infantry to go try to cover the flank because these skirmishers can't hold. You know, the cav's gonna go rushing through there. So, I sent these forward. Well, orderly withdrawal, I'm out of the way. Otherwise, it's kind of hard to see what to do. If I had another cav formation that I could send this way, that would be great. I've got my heavy guard cav. Maybe I should be sending that up that way. I've got this huge cav formation here, but I kind of don't want to cross the stream and try to attack, river. Actually, that's a question. Is this a major river or a minor river? It's not specified in the scenario. There's not much difference between the two. I actually think minor rivers are worse than major rivers. I don't remember. Minor river adds one. No, yeah, it's got to be a major river because it takes up a whole hex. I think that's the answer, but it's not obvious. Anyway, I guess this is why the free setup scenario for the Persians is, the Persian free setup is the only one they're supposed to have a chance at. The meeting engagement, basically, I don't remember what that does. Yeah, the meeting engagement doesn't really give the Persians much flexibility either. But this situation does not look very tenable. I'm just worried that I'm not really sure that I see something. I would dispatch some cav over here. That would be about the only real difference that I could see. Because you've got to have your best stuff kind of along the river. Otherwise, boom, right across the center. Well, now the good stuff's used up. I've got these reserve immortals, which are medium infantry, high quality, but, you know, they're not going to stand against the phalanxes. By the way, one rule that I have been not using, phalanxes can wheel without taking a penalty, which this has always been one of the two hex units have a lot of trouble maneuvering. Well, the phalanxes are very maneuverable, and I've been, I think, assessing the penalty against them. It's hard to tell. I don't know if I've actually assessed the penalty against many of them, but I've not moved them in certain fashions because of that wheeling penalty that applies to, like, the hoplites and apparently to these, I can't read. First time I've seen them. Let's see. Cardesis? I don't know. Something like that. And we move the rest of the formation forward here. That's a weird kind of thing. Craterus here is not a wing commander. So I've moved his he used an order to move the contingent commander for the Peltasts a little to the left, where it's more likely that, what, Parmenion? What's his name? Yeah, Parmenion is able to maybe be able to get him in half range. I don't know. Cav forming up into wedges, same as over here. I don't have enough wedge markers. I could use some square markers or something, but whatever. I'm okay right now. Get back to the columns. By the way, I didn't explain what these suckers do. They add one to the tactical quality of the units defending them, and they also provide a small penalty to crossing them when you attack, but that destroys them. And I guess we're pretty much done with everything except Alexander's elite, his regular actions, and I'm not quite sure what to do because I've moved everything, right? But one of my foci is to try to get across there quickly, so I think I'll probably push the companions through a little heavily, but I may also want to deal with these. I can't just keep withdrawing from them, so we'll see if we can dispatch him as kind of the first action. Didn't push quite as far as I had hoped. Momentum failure on Alexander's part, also on this flank, but that's not as important. But on Alexander's part, I wasn't able to get his big seven more activation points, which would have been useful. Especially given that one of my cav bounced off this light infantry here. We did get rid of the other. We're making our way through the skirmishers. And it looks like it's time to do the turn cleanup. Lex kind of misused his elite command, sent some forces across, got rid of one of the skirmishers, didn't get rid of the other, but then went back to rally this unit, and that's, you know, rather than trying to push forward with more units. But the problem was, you couldn't see what the results of the combat were, and I wouldn't have been able to move anything else forward. So this gives me a second rally, then I push them forward and can do some stuff. But the problem is, these infantry that were here have chased back some of the cav that was sent to deal with them. Did that get handled? I think I forgot to do an attack, but we'll just live with it as it is. And now there's, you know, a threat in my back area. Now, on the bright side, we do have some units that can cope with that. It's just, it's not exactly the situation that I want to be in. These guys are turning out to be something of a threat. Alexander succeeds in rallying that unit. Then running back up, clearing the way up here. These routed units, these are just some of the Persians from across here. You can see he's taking care of that. Just kind of get rid of that problem. Try to make the crossing as fast as possible. There are a lot of Persians heading in the direction of that crossing, though. But as that weakens the center, it makes it more plausible for me to launch an attack against the prepared position. I've also pushed some of the cav forward. I don't really intend to go smashing through there. I was kind of hoping the Persians would come across. They didn't, though. So, it would be pretty much suicide for them to do so, I think. And that's what I was thinking from both directions. But yeah, by shifting a lot of the forces in this direction, we might be able to stop this. If we can, then the Macedonians have to launch a frontal assault. If we can't, well, then the Macedonians just start clearing the, rolling up the flank as usual. I see no reason to, you know, use brute force tactics when I've got a clear outflank available. Alexander is pushed further up, smacked into one of these weird Peltas giant units, and knocked it out of the way. At some cost, no question. And then chasing these down, we have some Lancers over here. They fought this guy. He can't give an order anymore because he's fought in a personal combat. But Protomarchus or whatever was killed. Now, normally a leader being killed is a fair number of victory points, but because this is a contingent commander, as far as I can tell, he's worth nothing because he has no initiative of his own. And it's based on the initiative rating. I think that's a little goofy because he's definitely a component of the army, but he's not counted in. So he wouldn't count in scenarios where he's not there, and it doesn't increase the total route number. So I'm just going to count him as zero, but I think they probably should boost the route number for the armies a little bit. And they should also include... They should also have a slight penalty. I don't know what. You know, count them maybe as a half an initiative or something, so they'd cost like two or three points each. I'm very patient with the Macedonians in this one. I just don't trust my capability to smash through that with ease in the same way that I kind of felt like I could in the last river battle. So I'm concentrating here because it looks pretty easy so far. Broken up some of the skirmishers. There is a force coming forward. If, you know, the larger Persian force, although less quality definitely with these light infantry, etc., is able to be placed in there, it may actually slow things down and force me to launch an attack here against the now weakened center. You can see I cleared up those little light infantry that were kicking around there. Point-wise, not much is happening. The Persians have taken 18 points of losses. The Macedonians didn't take anything because I managed to save this unit, which is not looking like such a mistake anymore. Sometimes it feels like it is a mistake to, you know, run off and save one unit. But here, yeah, it wasn't like there was a lot I could do. I mean, Alexander ran down here. He ran back. He's able to get his commands off. And all of it. Now, that wasn't this turn. But this turn, you know, just mainly focusing on getting that cav across. Under brushes away those skirmishers. They actually provided an interesting challenge because the heavy cav hitting them loses their charge formation. So with cav behind the skirmishers in charge formation, there is an immediate, hey, I'll become attacker superior if I hit the cav that's dealing with them. Now, I was able to move around a little bit and get a light cav into place instead to brush them on the side. But it's not, you know, I'm not in as strong a position as I hoped I would be with my companions facing the Persian heavy cav. Now, I've got one companion and one light cav up here, neither of which are in charge formation, which means that they're a little bit more vulnerable. Okay, so this guy, I can't quite read him, Astromedes or something like that, rallied some of the cav, or I don't know, reorder, whatever. Rally is when they're routed. Only got one activation, so I brought Darius up, who also only got one activation, launched attacks. You can see he got a flank attack here. He actually drove one of the light cav away, then hit the heavy cav from the flank and couldn't handle it. The companion cav just has, you know, better tactical quality. So you can see one of these units is routed, and it's probably going off the board because I'm out of leaders on this side of the board. Now I got my central leader. Now I could run him over there. If all my leadership runs over there, wow, I bet you the Macedonians move forward. I chose, perhaps poorly, not to run up and try to rally this unit, but to stay sort of towards the middle, but continue shifting forces over. But that line's getting really thin back there. There's not a lot. You know, if I break through, it's a real breakthrough at this point. There's a secondary line here, obviously, but right at the over there, there's nothing. Of course, units can kind of, you know, double back and whatever, counter march, but we're not really getting, I was hoping to be able to drive the companions back with those flank hits, and that didn't happen. The flank hit here was due to a pursuit roll, which I let them keep charge formation because the way the pursuit rules are worded, you can get multiple pursuits. That can only be possible if they keep their charge formation. So again, this may be an error I haven't looked at the new rules to see how they work, but it gets close enough, you know. Pandy and Cav continue to clear a pathway. At this point, the points are beginning to accumulate against the Persians here. They lost another one of these, and those are worth 10 points each, just like if they were hoplites. Double-sized units are worth double points. I checked that one. And then, not one, but two of the heavy cav went. So we're up to 51 points. We're, you know, over a third of the way to loss. And more importantly, this flank, the Persian force is just really disordered and not in a position to withstand. Alexander didn't get his momentum. If he did, he would have healed his units a little bit. They may be a little too tired, a little too disorganized to launch the attack I want, although some of them are in good shape. I think we'll be able to continue rolling this forward, but there might be some risk to it. Meanwhile, this guy over here is continuing to funnel troops to that weak left flank, making things look weaker and weaker. Instead of taking advantage of it right away, though, this guy ran back and went and commanded these light cav to move forward, get them into Alex's range. He's going to need all the cav he's got because he's just focusing on that outflank. And that's end of turn. The companions in the elite initiative continue to wreak havoc on the Persian left flank here. Although this unit, which got struck from behind by a light cav, light infantry is pretty resilient to light cav, actually, and this is a big unit. The light cav was a very small unit. It just bounced right off, did very little damage. Ended up over on the one table with attacker superior, which, you know, it's not a healthy unit, but it's also not a badly damaged unit, or not a routed unit, at least. That attack came at something of a cost. One of the heavy cav got hit by a light infantry, which bounced off, routed, failed to be rallied. There was a full set of momentums for this guy here. But he got hit by an immortal. Now, immortals are interesting. I didn't realize this. They're archers. Medium infantry archers. Neat. And it makes sense. If you think about the Persian army, they have the, you know, noble bowmen with their shield masters, etc. Just a really interesting combination of force that I think there's something similar on the Japanese tradition as well. And in fact, I know there is. But with wicker shields and everything. The heavy cav, companion cav, got routed. Now, it was kind of in danger because things were clustered. But by the time... So the first attempt to attack it would have eliminated it completely, but then the first momentum is when the actual attack happened, because another light infantry ran up, tried to sneak around behind it, and routed. It was just like, I'm not attacking these guys. But this guy got smacked from the flank by the immortals, and now he's in kind of a tough position. He's got to try to wend his way through. Get a little bit of a line forming up there. Point-wise, well, we actually threw one of these Royal Guard heavy cav against a companion, and that just bounced off. It was against this companion. That just bounced off and routed, but at least I got to rally that. I got kind of lucky on that roll. Because the problem is I'm fighting near the edge of the map for the Persians, which means they're more likely to just disappear when they route. Point-wise, we're up to 62 on them. And now it's time for Darius to go. They simplified the Darius rules. Basically, he can run away from anything that comes towards him, but he has to run off towards the edge of the map, and if he leaves, it doesn't count against the army, which I think is a little wrong. I think there should be a penalty for running him off the map. It certainly demoralized the army, but that's not the case here. He can even run away from enemy leaders, which is important because he's a fairly decent melee combat leader, but Alexander is amazing. So if Alexander goes running after Darius, as historically happened, well, Darius pretty much has no chance of surviving in a personal combat with, well, I don't know. No chance is a little strong. But there's a 3-point bonus on here, so on average he'd be wounded, and there's a fair chance that you'll just kill him. And he's worth a fair amount of points. He's not great, you know? So I guess penal, you know, his army sucks so bad anyway, you don't really want to penalize it too much, but I feel like some route points for running him off the map makes some sense.
I think I may have screwed up ordering again, but
no, I did not. I get confused because there's one Macedonian five that comes in between all the Persians, and I did this right. The Macedonians pushed their peltasts forward, just kind of a probing attack, try to break up the command here. And they got rid of a few skirmishers, which is the main reason for doing it. But then they got repulsed with hoplite pushing forward. These archers, I've been kind of neglecting them. I forgot foot archers have a fair range. I thought it was just two hexes. That's slingers. And actually, I've been neglecting the slingers, thinking they only had a one hex range. So these guys I commanded and did several fires. And, you know, that's just weakening the Macedonian line a little bit, making it harder for the next attempt to advance forward. So those archers up there are actually a pretty potent force. I didn't realize how good they were. Which isn't really going to probably affect the battle because of the choice to do the... sorry for my shaky hand. To focus more on the outflank than trying to charge straight across, but the attacks that are happening may not have even happened had I been firing continuously. Anyway, this guy got his full momentums, and yeah, you can see routed a couple of those peltasts. It's not going to be pleasant charging across, but I wanted to get rid of some of the skirmishers is kind of the thing, because I see them as, oh great, my hoplites charge in, they hit the skirmishers, or my phalanx charges in, it hits the skirmishers, and then it's got a hoplite line right behind it. As long as the skirmishers stand and fire. If the skirmishers run or withdraw, then they serve no purpose whatsoever. So it's kind of tough because they're still worth only like 1 point each. Their current point value 65-8. And yeah, that heavy cav got knocked out. Actually, called some chariots to ride by him and shoot him up. Chariots are just great. These are actually decent chariots. They have a high morale factor, which means, you know, when you see them in like the successor battles or in certainly in SPQR's coverage of the successor battles, I don't know about the ones in here, they're just so pointless. You know, they're rated like with a 2 or 3 tactical quality, but here with a 7 tactical quality, these things can still have a strong effect on the battle because the chariot table is the same as the one in Chariots of Fire. They're still good units if they can get their attack off, but usually they just fail their TQ check. The Macedonian left flank launches more of the peltasts here, clearing most of the skirmishers out. Now that's a bad trade-off if you think about it, because the peltasts pay their full tactical quality, which is generally 5, whereas the skirmishers are only worth 1 point each. But the skirmishers disappear when you rout them. The peltasts, when you rout them, stay on the map, so it's only when you're trying to rally them. It's still probably not a great trade-off, but I want to clear them out of there, and I don't really see too much use for my peltasts, at least immediately, and they were positioned in the front, so I threw them forward. I'm still not happy with the trade-off. We're at 70-13. Now it's time for Alexander to launch his last couple activities. If he gets them both, he gets one for free. And Big Al has pretty much just been recovering units and moving his line forward. He's facing an interesting problem here. Just like there's a penalty for edge of the map because your routed units go flying off, there's also a benefit, especially when facing a cav outflank like this. Those light infantry, the infantry in general, holds up pretty well to cav if it can't slip around behind it. If we look first of all at the heavy cav, their attacker's superior against skirmishers and other cav if they're charging it. But there's a defender superior for most of the heavier infantry. And the regular infantry, if we take a look, heavy cav versus light infantry, it's at the 8 table, which is nothing bad, but it's not great. And then the heavier ones are on increasingly more troubled tables. Now, cav is a more limited resource. Obviously, the crappy infantry isn't so hot, but, you know, when we're looking at the Immortals or something, yeah, there aren't a lot of them, but they stiffen the line significantly, and even these suckers, if I can get them facing so they don't get outflanked, they can be something of a hindrance to the cav. So, I'm not expecting the companions to have a huge problem breaking through, but it's a lot uglier once a line is formed facing them than otherwise, which is kind of why, well, the cav here doesn't want to go charging across, hit light cav, and then have the heavy cav smash into it or whatever as it's weakened. So there's actually a possible opportunity here for the Persians to stream across. It hurts their quality, but if you look, the Thessalians, the Greek allies, these aren't all that great. So if I can get a breach in this flank, then I can threaten the important phalanx forces, potentially. Which, you know, it would be even better if they engage, because they'll be, you know, in an even weaker position where they can't even really wheel around and do anything about it. But that's beginning to look more and more plausible as the Peltast line is disintegrating. Well, you know, that was something of the defense for those Macedonians. Maybe I didn't want to send them forward. We'll see. Alexander's initiative gains him a little bit more ground, but you can see he got hit in a couple of places. Some of the Immortals, some light infantry that snagged in a flank shot on these Lancers. Just, you know, this is still an ongoing fight, essentially. It's not decided yet. A little bit of playing around here where Alexander actually got a die roll of doom bonus to be able to activate again, which he used for recovery. But I guess the major thing is this guy pushed forward, helping rally some of the center here, but yeah, kind of a mixed thing. I haven't charged this yet, but then ran back here and pushed the rest of the Peltast back across the river. Now, and some rallying or recovery as well. But I had to counter march a couple of units back towards the line here because there's a gap. Right now, things are looking pretty weak on the Persian center, but the problem, of course, is there's a bunch of routed Peltasts in the way that I kind of have to do something about it. I'm not sure what yet. As you see, a portion of the Persian cav has crossed the river and smacked into the Thessalian cav mainly, and driving it back. Here we had some Greek allied cav lights that got hit. Had two activations total. The second one, Alexander tried to trump in and failed. He's now finished. So all we've got left is the center here. And the question really is, well, given what we saw, do we want to try to push forward right now or not? There's a weakness right here. I was intending to go forward in it. I think I will anyway, even though there's a threat of an outflank. Ragged line of hoplites held against the phalanx strike. Lost a couple of cav here. I wasn't really paying too much attention. And they, because they're fast, they were able to rout off the map. I didn't really have an opportunity unless I had flung this guy over to try to save them, and well, instead I decided to pound into here, which probably turns out to be a mistake if the hoplites can hold out. Remember, they get their saving throws. These weird things don't. And point-wise, because of that, we're down to 35 for the Macedonians and 79 for Persia. Alexander launches his heavy cav again, maybe biting off more than he can chew here. Especially since it's exposing flanks for those cav, that's going to be problematic. Of course, you can do a withdrawal and take cohesion hits for that. But he blasted a couple of the Immortals out of the way. And, well, has another one here that he's taking in the rear now. And there's not a lot left. There's some light infantry, but basically all the good stuff's going from there. So I feel a little bit safer charging forward at this point. And a number of very effective counterattacks, including the bodyguard chariots, slam and kill a couple more of the companions here in total. They exposed them too much, and the light infantry got it surrounded, etc. Drove another one back. Got some pretty good action going on over here. Part of it is there were a fair number of momentums. Darius got all three of his activations. One of these guys got an extra activation. And that gets us to points, 51 to 105, but the battlefield situation looks a lot worse for the Macedonians than the numbers would reflect. If this fails, this looks like at best a wash for them, as does this. So, you know, if one of those line, if one of the sections actually breaks, and the Persians get the advantage in a section, that could be very bad. And this is the most likely place for that to happen. Although it could even happen over here. There aren't many good units left. I think there's only, well, there's companions here that can be thrown back into the meat grinder. But yeah, it's not a very strong position anymore on this flank. It looked like they were rolling it up, but that heavy commitment over here is working pretty well. And now, hey, you know, if this continues to go the Persians' way, there's problems in the center. And if some of those phalanxes start to collapse, if they're, you know, if they break somehow, this could turn around pretty quickly. But there aren't a lot of points left for the Persians. They only have 30 points left that they can lose. This is turning out to be more of a fight than I thought it would be, though. Maybe because of my incompetence, but who knows. We're looking a little too good to be true on the Persian side over here. These aren't any particularly special cav. They're actually facing better Bactrians, but when you launch an attack, quite often you end up a little out of position. And position is a lot in this game. So a number of flank attacks and or units in charge formation hitting units not in charge formation, we've pretty much broken up that entire attack. There are more waves to come. It's not a done deal yet on either side, but it's not looking like they're just going to roll up that flank real easily. It did require two momentums to get that far. Now, I could have tried trumping in or something, but none of the attacks looked like they were all that big an advantage. And with the accumulation of losses over here on the Cav side, 138 for Persia, they're actually over the limit. And then Craterus's push broke some of these hoplite units. I don't even have to take Alexander's turn. This battle is over. So we'll load this one up. I didn't realize that I was already over, but the push of the hoplites, the push of the phalanx and the hoplite combined. Actually, we lost one of our hoplites. Uh-oh. But that's not anywhere near enough to send things over. So this was actually kind of an interesting one. There was some excitement, and I felt like, well, if they had a little bit more padding to their morale, the Persians could have made another push here. Maybe they should have done it earlier. I don't know. Certainly, I was impressed with the line that they formed at the end and the fact that they were able to kind of recover and not just get rolled up. Part of that had to do with the edge of the map situation. All right, up it goes.